To explain one of the key links to black history in Scotland, I've brought you to the Perthshire town of Auchterarder. Now, if that seems surprising, it's because people don't realise that links to the slave trade are all around us. If you want to know more, then come inside this churchyard. Oh, by the way, if you're interested in the people, places and events in Scottish history, then subscribe to the YouTube channel Scotland History Tours. In the meantime, let me tell you a story. I want to start by telling you about Frederick Douglass. Now, there'll be people watching who already know about Frederick Douglass. Much of the Scottish black community, people who are interested in US or Scottish history, people who campaign for racial equality. You know, the kind of folk you'd want to have at a dinner party. Oh, I've heard the word woke used to insult people. I'll be honest, I've never gotten the bother of finding out what this insult woke means. Because frankly, the people I've heard used it are the kind of people that you wouldn't want to invite to a dinner party. Anyway, for those who haven't heard, Frederick Douglass was born a slave in Maryland in 1818. He was born Frederick Bailey. That was his slave name. Incidentally, what a lot of people don't know is that Malcolm X was once invited to the prestigious New York Mathematician's Annual Ball, and his invitation said X plus one. The strange thing is, none of the mathematicians could work out why. Don't worry, Frederick Douglass was no good at algebra either, but he was good with words. As a teenager, he was taught to write by his slave mistress until her husband found out. He went daft and stopped it. Now you might be thinking that believing the ability to write was a bad thing meant he was daft in the first place. And of course, you'd be right. But keep it quiet. Some white folks still don't know that we can read. He escaped and fled to the north. He changed his name from Bailey to Douglas, inspired by Sir Walter Scott's writings in the Black Douglas of Robert the Bruce fame, so I'm told. Come on the chalks! Before long, his charisma and eloquence meant that he was lecturing for the anti-slavery movement, and he wrote a book about his life story and escape, which in those days sold 30,000 copies in 5 years. Now, revealing these details put him in danger of being recaptured, so sending a copy of his book to his ex-master was ballsy. But it might not have been the smartest thing he'd ever done. Anyway, it was safer for him to be across an ocean, and in 1845 he set off for Britain, and he carried out a tour of speaking engagements. Now, many of you will have heard about this tour. Some of you will know about the impact of this tour. A few of you might even know the slogan that was being shouted in the towns and cities and rhymed in songs: send the money back. The point is that some of you will have heard about Frederick Douglass, but less of you will know about this place. This is the old parish church of Auchterarder. Now, it's only the graveyard that's left now, that and the tower. But this is a central place in the history, not only of the Scottish church, but in the wider life of civic Scotland, and indeed in the tour of Frederick Douglass. Let's have a seat and talk about it. It all started with the Reformation. In England, the Reformation happened because Henry VIII wanted to marry Anne Boleyn. Now, when the Pope said no, Henry thought, much better if the King was head of the church rather than the Pope. So now, the monarch is the head of the Church of England. He would appoint bishops rather than the Pope. The point is that whether the Catholic or the Anglican Church, the clergy were appointees of patrons. Now, in Scotland, the Reformation happened slightly differently. It was more bottom up. It was a congregation who appointed the minister. The church was independent of the patronage of the crown or landowning interests. Now, this wasn't always straightforward. Throughout the 17th and 18th century, the union of the crowns, the bishops' wars, English civil wars and stuff like that, there was a constant fight and tension between the Scottish Presbyterian system and the more anglicised Episcopalian system of patronage. Now, it's too much death and with too little time, suffice to say that in the 1707 Act of Union, Scotland was promised that it would keep its Presbyterian bottom-up, people-choose-the-minister type arrangements. Then,
4 years later, the British Parliament reintroduced the right of patrons to appoint ministers by passing the Church Patronage Scotland Act. Aye, you never saw that coming, did you? That came out of left field. Promise you anything and stay part of the union, then once you vote, then...
Mr. Fummey!
Right, Black History. So, the Church of Scotland regularly complained about the patronage thing, but nothing ever happened. Things came to a head in this church on the 31st of August 1834 because the minister here, the Reverend Charles Stewart, died. 2 weeks later, the Earl of Canoole put forward his replacement, the Reverend Robert Young. The congregation voted and said, no, we didn't want him, and they blocked the ordination. Now, the Reverend Young and the Earl of Canoole went to the court, and the case was found in their favour. In the 1707 Union, the Church of Scotland was guaranteed by law, but the law determined that in the state religion, patronage was protected. This landmark case was swiftly followed by more. So long story short, in 1843, about 400 ministers said, right, that's it, we're out of here. We're not prepared to remain in an established church where the state can impose ministers chosen by the landed elite. We must have freedom to choose. They walked out of the Church of Scotland and set up the Free Church of Scotland. There was one problem. The established Church of Scotland had all the churches, land, and revenues. The new Free Church had freedom to meet out in the open air. They needed to build churches, and they needed the money to do it. The spark had been lit here at Auchterarder Parish Church 9 years before. Now let me show you something 300 metres down the road. You see, here in Auchterarder, because their dispute had started 9 years earlier, by the time the schism happened, they designed and built the church that you can see behind me, which became the first free church in Scotland just in time for the schism. The problem was that the free church needed to raise money for lots more. They'd appealed far and wide for benefactors. Now, it just so happened that there were Presbyterians of Scots descent in the southern states of America who were only too willing to donate funds. So the Free Church of Scotland, who found the imposition of ministers by landowners such an intolerable restriction on freedom that it wasn't to be borne, gratefully received funds from landowners who owned human beings as chattel. The slave owners gave money, and they were lent credibility and a tacit moral acceptance from across the ocean and from part of what had been the Mother Church. Slave owning can't be that bad. It funds God's work. What neither slavers nor the Free Kirk had reckoned on was Frederick Douglass, who arrived in Scotland in 1846 to travel the country preaching the gospel of abolitionism. He preached to large and receptive audiences throughout the country, and the cry went up across the land, send the bloodstained money back. It was sung in songs. It was shouted in the streets. It was written on paper. Some enterprising young women even had it carved on Arthur's seat for all in Edinburgh to see. Send the money back. The hypocrisy of the Free Church provided a rallying cry for abolitionists and an easy target for their detractors in the established church. So they gave the money back.
Of course they didn't. What are you like? People will always find a convoluted way to justify a morally indefensible position if it's convenient for them to do so. My comfort in a pew in Paisley far outweighs any discomfort felt by some black in Cottonfield, Carolina. But you knew that anyway. That's not history. That's current affairs. Even now, we see all sorts of contorted justifications of why equality isn't a priority. They say all lives matter. But if they really believed all lives matter, then they'd be saving refugees in the Mediterranean or the English Channel. But they're not. If they really believed all lives matter, then they'd be screaming out for justice for the poor and downtrodden in society. But they're not. If they really believed that all lives mattered,
then they would be campaigning on behalf of the poor, underdeveloped countries affected by climate change caused by the rich, developed ones. But they're not. They don't actually mean all lives matter. What they mean is that their life matters more and they don't want to change. So if the congregation will open our books and sing Psalm 1999 in the consumerism hymnal, "I'm All Right, Jack, Don't Know About You," we'll remain seated in our comfortable church of privilege to sing. Of course, I'm making a sweeping generalisation about a group of people, and I'm lumping them all together as being ignorant, contemptible, and all the same. I know. It's wrong, isn't it? But the fact of the matter is that we all do it to varying degrees. Black, white, left, right, unionist, independent. Not only that, but I, Bruce Fummey, benefit from slavery today. Much of the physical infrastructure that we enjoy in Britain today, Victorian bridges, buildings, economic development, and first world status, much of that came from the fruits of that trade. Every time I take a train from Glasgow to Aberdeen, I benefit from black enslavement. If I'm honest, I haven't really checked my wardrobe. I may be benefiting from a modern counterpart. So here's a question to ask yourself honestly. Would you have sent the money back? Would I? It's not a judgment on our past. It's a question to help us plan for the future. I mean, Doc is going to be a llama alive. Cheering Rastin.